is about Bayesian fitting. It's a toolbox written in Python for fitting data and calculating the evidence. Yeah. So that's the outline of the talk. And here, if you were wondering what this was about, an example of some fit. It's actually the sea level on the North Sea measured on the coast with respect to NAP, and between 1900 and 2015 or so. And you can see it fits a nice straight line. I'll come back to that later in my talk. So, first, myself. I am Doug Kester. I studied mathematics and astronomy in Amsterdam till 75. And when I was there, my supervisor gave me a book on Fortran 4 and said, read this. And I said, I do this. Oh yes, I can do this. And that was my education. And then I worked at ESRON in Groningen. ESRON is Netherlands Institute for Space Research, the Dutch NASA, until 2014, I did calibration on satellite instruments. I was the interface between the data coming down from the satellite and the astronomer on the other side. So organized the data, calibrated the data, things like that. I worked on ANS, ERAS, ISO, Akari is the Japanese satellite. These are all the first one is a Dutch satellite, the other one is also more or less Dutch, European satellite, Japanese satellite, European satellite. And I, in the course of the time, I did Fortran, Pascal, C, IDL, Java, Titan. And I'm retired since 2014 and work a little bit on JWST, the successor of Hubble, on the Dutch instrument there. And worked in Python. So how does this Bayesian fitting thing comes about? It started in the 90s when ESA decided to make a complete ground segment from scratch for the Herschel satellite. So it had to do satellite operations. Upload and download, interactive analysis, pipeline of the observation, that all the observations need to go to be processed in some way or another, and then stored into the database. It was a big project, over 25 years lasted it, a lot of people working on it, distributed over three continents, and it was successful. It was written in Java, and for the interaction we used Titan. So, I was new to Java, so I thought, well, I read a book, and I need a project. So I had experience in fitting data. So I thought, well, I tried my hand on that, and I knew what I wanted to have, because. I had experience on these previous projects. A big thing is that I had a short cycle, a short error and expansion cycle, because if I made something wrong, I could repair it immediately. That's a big thing. And it's, of course, a non-trivial thing. So it's good for learning something. And this became Herschel Numeric Toolbox Fit, part of HCSS, the common Herschel Common Software System. And this whole thing was copyrighted under GPL3. So, in 2016, this whole project stopped, and maintenance stopped for HCSS. So there was no one responsible anymore, so but still I felt, well, this whole thing, all this effort is going down the drain. So I thought, well, maybe I can separate it from the HCSS and translate it to Python. So I found on the web a little program, a Java to Python. It's not too good, but it worked for my purpose. That is, it maintained the structure, it put all the documentation in place that I already had, so I hate retyping things. But then I, of course you had to inspect all the code lines for Python, and I built it up on NumPy and SciPy, and this way it became Bayesian fitting. Since 2018 it's in GitHub, and since the beginning of this year it's also in PyPy and Zenedo. Now what does it do? Model fitting. What is model fitting? Assume you have data, X and data measured, data D measured at some point at points X, and you want to have a parameterized function through it, f of x and p, and then you have to find the parameters p such that the errors are minimal. Now, minimal errors, Gauss. Before Gauss, people didn't know how to do this. They just did something. They guessed, I think. Gauss advised to minimize the sum of the squares. Well, if you don't know, you have to do something. He advised to minimize the sum of the squares, which is the famous least square procedure. Laplace, he advised to minimize the absolute values. It produces median-like values. These are both valid. They are ways or shortcuts here to maximize the likelihood. Now we go to Bayes' rule because it's Bayesian fitting. Why can you say something about parameters of a model if you know the data? That's not obvious from the start. Well, it is because we have, if you have a probability of two events, A and B, here in the middle, the probability of A, comma B, given some information I, then you can look at that in two ways. You can say, first say, whether A is, you look at what the probability of A is, and then if you know what the probability of A is, that's a given. So it goes to the other side. And then you look at what the probability of B is. So you can do that in the first, and but A and B are A and B. I mean, you can change them. So you can also look at B first, and then have an A. And if you now rearrange that a little bit, you get a Bayes rule, which is standing there, probability of B given A and I is the probability of B given I times probability of A given B and I divided by the probability of A given I. Well, that's very abstract. What does it do? Well, now we fill it in the data. The probability of the parameters given the data and the model. M is the I is the model. Is the probability of the parameters and given the model times the probability of the data given the parameters and the model divided by the data given the model. So, in words, all these things have a name. The first thing is the posterior, then we get the prior, the likelihood, and the evidence. Now, again, that's the same thing. The posterior is the probability of the parameters after applying the data. The prior is the probability of the parameters before the data. I'll get to that later on. The likelihood is the data given the parameters. That was the error that we had before, that we want to minimize. And the evidence, that's just a constant for now. A constant which makes the posterior integrate to 1, because it's a probability and it has to integrate to 1. And then we can also, it can also be shown that you can play this on different levels, so you can also look at what the probability of the model is given the data. And that is that is proportional to the probability of the model given, of the data given the model. Evidence is an important thing here, because you can determine whether one model is better than another model. Now, here we have that again. So, when the prior can be ignored, for instance, when it's uniform, then you don't care where it is, then the Bayesian solution is the same as the maximum likelihood solution. If the likelihood is Gaussian, is a Gaussian error distribution, then the maximum likelihood distribution is the same as the least square. So, when you did least square, you were okay. Now, we finally get to basic fitting. That was the introduction. It cost me 10 minutes. Basic fitting has a number of directories. The source files, I'll get to that next. And it has documentation with a manual, design document, a trouble section where I collect all the errors that I made in all the times. A glossary of the names, a style document. It has examples in Jupyter notebooks, and it has test harnesses. So, in the source directory, there are over 100 classes, 50 models, about 20 fitters, one nested sampler, which is a fully Bayesian optimizer, that needs error distributions, priors, engines, problems, and so on, and then some other stuff. Now, we get to the models. This is a design picture, inheritance picture. At the bottom we have the base model, and then the fixed model inherits from base model, model inherits, and so forth, and so on. Above there are the what I call simple models, that are just the models that you would think of, say, a polynomial model, a Gauss model. All the black things down there are abstract models. You don't care about them. However, they, of course, have an important role, because they have all these attributes and things, because every fitter acts on a model, the thing that was central in that picture. So the number of parameters is in there, the parameters themselves, the dimension of the inputs. You can have more than one array of inputs. The results, which is the functional result of the result of the function. Then the partials with respect to p. Now that we have derivative with respect to numeric partials. I like that, because if you have a new model, you want to know whether your partials are okay, and you compare it with the numeric partials. If they're not okay, you're not okay. The base model sits at the bottom of the tree, but actually it's the base model for the things at the top of the tree. But they have to go through all this stuff, because everything has to be a model. So, a base model, it has all these results, but now the base model, the model, when you call the result of a model, then it calls the super and the super until you're at the base model, and then the base model reaches out to the top, and it calls in the simple model, it calls the base result. And so on for all the other things. Now, let me show a few simple models. You can do from basic fitting import, well, whatever, I now imported everything. And then the blue line is a polynomial model, the green line is a Arctanax model, the red line is a Gauss model, and if you do print green, then you get something like. The next step up is a fixed model, where you can fix one of the parameters. You can fix it either by a constant, then it's just like you have a model with one parameter less, and of course it's replaced by this model. But you can also replace it by another model. And then that is interesting, because if you replace it by another model, you get certainly a completely different model. Let's see here. We have an exponential model. For the fun, I fixed this thing, but on the other hand, I have to choose some parameters which I have not listed here. So, and then the sine, the green model, the red model is of course also there. The green model is the sine model where I fixed it. That is the first parameter, which is the period of the sine model, is now replaced by the exponential model. And what is the result? The result is a chirp. So it's a sine which goes up and up in tone. Another thing, in model itself, we have compound models. And every model has a connection to a next. And there can be another model, or a none. If it's none, then the chain ends. But every next model has also an operator associated with it. Addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and one special one is a pipe, where you feed the first model to the next model as input. It also gives rise to quite interesting new possibilities. Here we have addition and subtraction. Say we have red is a polynomial model, say a sloping polynomial model plus a Gauss model, you see that there. And then we have an absorption on a normalized background, so polynomial model. Then I fix at zero and I subtract the first model. The first model is a stellar line model. Now we have multiplication and division. Here we have to do, if we multiply what I want to do, we multiply an Artangas model with a Gauss model, both of these things have an amplitude. Now, then you have two amplitudes which are the same, so you cannot do that because you have to generate. So you have to fix one. Fix. So in the Artangas model, I fix it. I fix one at one. And then the red model is a power model plus a power model to the zero, which is actually one. X to the power one. And the other one is x to the power 4, and then I divide that thing by a constant. I have a constant model and divide the red bar by it. And then you get this funny shape. Now, if you look at this, this green one, then you can see that both the Artangas model and the Gauss model, they both have a central position. But they could be different. If you now want to have them operate in the same way, then you show that this whole pattern shifts in the same way. Then you can do a pipe. So we have an Artangas model that is fixed, and now I have to fix the center position of it. I have the Gauss model where I fix the amplitude at one, and also the shift of its of internally I fix at zero. So, and I have a polynomial model where I have only the offset plus the x, and then I pipe it, and this thing will go to there and there, because these two things, if you do this like that, they will be within in a bracket. Bracket, that brings us to bracket models. Most of the times we don't need it, actually. But you can see that the models are just processed one by one sequentially. And if you want to have, so M1 plus M2 times M3 is done as M1 plus M2 times M3, all of them. So if you want to have that, M1 plus M2 times M3, then you have to use the bracket model, or you just do something like this. Well, because it's automatically invoked when the chain, when you add a chain which is larger than one. So M1 plus M2 times M3 is processed as that. So I don't think you. I have not seen places where we actually need this, because if you do a smart grouping, then you can get that. So this is more for the astronomers. A Kombi model, where you can do a repetition of the same things, the repetition of Gauss models, for instance, and you can make similar data at a fixed distance or at a fixed ratio. This whole pattern will shift in one as one, and it's useful for multiplets in spectroscopy. Now. These models I skip, the kernel models, because I was already afraid that I would not have enough time. So we go to fitters. Now, a fitter is something that minimizes the data. We have least square fitters, we have linearly square fitters, which are direct. Non-linearly square fitters, which are also always iterative, and we have maximum likelihood fitters. Here is a design document of that. These two red things are encapsulations of things that are in SciPy. So how do you call a fitter? You say fitter is some of these fitters, and it might be a map. So then you say map is true, and it will take its information of the x and the y from the image. And then you do fit y. You can keep something, you can plot it, and you can add weights if you want. Weights, they have the same shape as the y data. And it's organized in such a way that if you have a weight of 2, then it's the same. Then it's the same as if you have that data point twice. Now, that I always prefer weights above, say, standard deviations, because you don't need to have standard deviations. Weights could be from somewhere else. Now, and you can have a weight of 0, which is also nice, because then the point is just not there. The base fitter does all these kind of things. Like if you run the fit, then you can do the standard deviation. You can determine the scale of the remaining noise, the confidence region, covariance, evidence. You can calculate all these things because they all originate from the Hessian matrix. And we have a direct fitter. For linear processes, we can have direct fitters. That's easy. I mean, if you can do that, take it, a linear model, because the chi-square landscape has only one minimum. So you can go directly there, and in one operation of the Hessian matrix. It's good for, say, less than 100 parameters. If you can still invert the matrix, then you're okay. Here is the example of that we had before. You see, x data is the year, y data is the level, polynomial model of 1, so linear slope, fitter, x data model, parameters, fit, y data, plot is true. Okay, then we have that plot. Now, I can see why the government is not so concerned about the rising of the sea level, if you see this plot, because it goes up by 1.8 millimeter a year. Okay, I think we can handle that if it stays like that. But then, if you go to say the year zero, or the year zero, Year zero doesn't exist. To the year one, then you see that it's 3 meters, 3 meters 60 above, below what it is now. I don't think that was the case. So something has changed.
Climate discussion. This was the climate discussion. This,
then you have iterative fitters. They go iteratively downhill until they find a minimum. If it's a good minimum, the global minimum, then you're done. But if it's not, then you're in, well, I don't know. So that's the pitfall. Find a local minimum. Different fitters have different strategies, and different strategies to find the minimum. So let's go to something interesting. And Robert Boyle had a the gas word, pressure times volume is constant. We still have his data. So I fitted that data. I have this thing, and Leverberg Marquardt fitter, because it's a nonlinear fit. And I can calculate the evidence, which for this model is minus 4.6. So how does this look? It does look like this. And you can see here the residuals, the difference between the model and the data, they're structured. They're not random. So there's something in here. So the suggestion was already that we might have a problem with these 0 points. So we do a new model where we have a 0 point in both the volume and the pressure. Calculate, do everything again, and now we have three parameters, and calculate the evidence again. 0.7 minus 0.7. Here it is now. The residuals are much better. And the evidence went up from minus 4.6 to minus 0.7, which is almost 4 in the log, which means that this model is 10 to the power 4 more probable than the previous one. Which does not say that this is the right model. That's something different. Now, we have maximum likelihood fitters. And we have there different livelihoods that you can fit in. I won't go into there because I want to do something more, and that is nested sampling. Nested sampling is an algorithm which is fully Bayesian, and it gives you your solution in the form of samples. And the evidence is the integral over the samples. That's immediately calculated. The priors are not ignored. We have pluggable things, randomization errors, error distributions, and so here we have what the algorithm is. You start off with say an ensemble of points, 100 points in the space. That in your prior space, and then you calculate the likelihood of all of them, and you look for the worst one, which is this, with cross around it, and throw it away. Actually, you put it you store it in the list with the proper weight, and then you take another one of the others, and so that is duplicated. And one of these two, you move around randomly until you find a new position. And then you go on and on and on. Until you finally move to the top of the likelihood. Yeah, ik klik haal het niet. Maar goed. Laat me deze even kijken. Zal ik dit misschien deze? Here you can see how this works. The yellow points are the samples which are actually rejected. The red points are my ensemble. So it's moving into the top, you see. And these are the data, the blue ones are the data. And the green one is my model. And you can see that it's slowly creeping to the top of that thing, and where the solution is to be found. Well, anyway,
I'm sorry, I had too much. Actually, internally, it's just a model which says, now run this model. Run this model. It's a model which has two other models inside it, and it just says, run that model. And then it gives that result back.
Can you maybe give an example?
No. If you have a model, if you have three models and you want to yeah, I can't give an example, but I have to think about it. You want an example where it's obvious that you want to do something like that. Well, it was with the...
let's see what...
Oh, the forget account. Here. Before you divide here, this one. Now, what do I have this one? FXP is 0.1 divided by that thing. And that thing is two models, actually. So I have to have a bracket around it, because otherwise I would have a constant model divided by this power model 0 plus that thing, and would be completely different.
Can you also do other sampling, like dip sampling, or
the engines? There are engines which can do skip sampling, yes, and Galilean sampling and step sampling, lots of things.
Thank you very much.